this out with Becca. I believe it. I've seen it.
Hi, Crossing family. My name is Andy Aki, and I'm one of the elders serving on staff. And first of all, before I begin, let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for your Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you for your word. Father, I just pray that you anoint what I have to say. Father, I pray you anoint our hearts and our ears. Father, I just pray that your word will bear fruit. In your name I pray. Amen. Little caveat before I get started, what I'm going to talk about tonight, I'm really preaching to myself, and you get to just listen in, and we'll see if you can gain any benefit from this or not. But this Sunday, HUD will be speaking on the state of the church. What I'd like to talk tonight about is the state of our heart. Scripture speaks of our spiritual heart. It's the center of our spiritual being. The heart is the center of our motives, our most deeply held beliefs and faith, of our thoughts, of our will, and it's the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit. However, since the fall of man, our hearts have been corrupted. We call this the sinful nature. When we accept Christ, we start a lifelong process of our hearts being changed. Now, oftentimes, we'll hear stories of someone accepting Christ and there will be immediate changes in their heart. And while this is common, to get our hearts to the Christ-likeness, to the nature of Christ, this is often a lifetime process that just really takes a lot of our attention. Religion speaks of rules and laws that are followed to earn whatever that religion's concept of heaven is. However, Jesus focuses on the condition of our heart, particularly our faith, our actions, and what motivates those actions. If our hearts are right, then our faith will be right, our intentions and motives will be right, and our actions will be right. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus skewered the Pharisees. They were doing some good things. They were fasting, they were praying, they were giving. But the problem was they were doing all these good things and right things for the wrong reason. They weren't doing it for their love of God or for their love of people. They were doing it to draw attention to themselves, to show how spiritual they were, to gain status in their culture. Elsewhere in the New Testament, we see where the Pharisees would also have another heart problem. They would do good things, but again, they did them for the wrong reason. They would do it in order to earn God's approval. They felt if they did enough good works, they would earn their salvation and right standing with God. They could not trust God's word and God's grace. However, we've got a serious problem with the heart in addition to the sinful nature. Jeremiah writes in chapter 17 about this. He says, "The heart is more deceitful than anything else and incurable. Who can understand it?" And the problem is we're often unaware of just exactly what's going on in the depths of our hearts. What are we blinded to? Well, James in chapter 1 talks about one problem we have. He says, "Be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving ourselves." Sometimes we think that as long as we agree with what we hear in church or we agree with what we hear what Scripture says, that that's good enough. Other issues we have is that we, like the Pharisees, do good works, but not out of love of God or people. We do it to bring attention to ourselves, to impress others how good or spiritual we are, or to get status in our Christian subculture. And at times we also run into the problem of trying to earn our right standing with God. We unfortunately reject his grace and think his love is conditional. In 1 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 3 through 5, we hear the Apostle Paul talk about his own heart. He says, "In fact, I don't even judge myself, for I am not conscious of anything against myself, but I am not justified by this. It is the Lord who judges me. So don't judge anything prematurely before the Lord comes, who will both bring to light what is hidden in darkness and reveal the intentions of the heart." Even super spiritual Apostle Paul couldn't be 100% sure that the intentions of his heart were correct and pure. Now, he wasn't questioning his salvation. He had no doubts there. He was questioning his true level of Christ-likeness. Now, let's say you develop chest pain, chest discomfort, some shortness of breath, or other symptoms suggesting you might have a problem with your physical heart. The only way to find out what the real physical health of your heart is to test it. This might involve an angiogram or an echocardiogram, but oftentimes a stress test is ordered. Your heart rate is stressed to the point where it's fast enough that we can see how your heart responds. While many patients don't want to believe that they have a heart problem, typically men, the only way to find out for sure is to test it. In the same way a physical stress test works to reveal a physical heart condition, there is also such a thing as a spiritual stress test that can show us the condition of our spiritual heart. In James chapter 1, verses 2, he writes, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. If any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him." The Greek word for trial is perasmos, which can be translated as an experiment or a test. Now, when we hear of other Christians going through trials and testings, we often just think they're going through a bad time in life, and that's all we consider. But let's think, why does a teacher give a test? A teacher gives a test to find out what the student really knows and how well they can apply it. Why do we have a legal trial? To hopefully bring out the truth of what really happened. What does an experiment do to show what is the truth regarding the physical world? So the trials James is talking of and speaking about are situations that typically involve some type of discomfort, financial, physical, or emotional, that tests us to bring out the truth of where we are in our heart, where our love and our faith stand. Now, I think most of us would agree that the events of 2020 have been stressful. COVID and all the negative effects on our society, our economy, and even it's made tough to even practice church the way we'd like to. The racial tensions, the ugly tone of our politics, just the divisiveness of our country, it's been stressful. But what I'm asking you to do to take the perspective that the events of 2020 are not stressful, but they are instead spiritual stress tests. James says if we endure our trials and allow our hearts to be changed, that will result in our spiritual growth and maturity. Testing and trials serve to help us see what our hearts are and give us the opportunity to become more like Christ. The more like Christ we become, the more joy, peace, and contentment we will experience now and for eternity. So, how's your spiritual heart doing with your 2020 stress test? Are you finding yourself more concerned with your comfort and safety than serving others? Are you finding yourself fearful that God won't provide a means for you to take care of yourself and your family? Are you finding that you now have some fear of death, that your eternity is maybe not as secure with God as you thought? Are you finding it harder to praise God and His goodness? Are you finding it harder to be thankful for what God's provided you? Are you finding yourself feeling superior to those who have different philosophical or political viewpoints than you? Are you finding yourself feeling superior to those who are not responding to the pandemic the way you think they should? Are you finding yourself more concerned with being right than being loving? with sharing your opinion more than sharing God's love? Are you looking forward more to sports returning to normal than church returning to normal? Are you finding yourself self-medicating with excessive entertainment, food, alcohol, substances, or even porn? Are you finding that you're not so generous anymore? So, how's your spiritual heart doing with your 2020 stress test? Are you finding you need a stent or two? Maybe a bypass or two? Maybe just a change in diet, what you're taking in? Or maybe you need a whole heart transplant? Realize that this kind of a stress test is a good thing. Just like a physical stress test can show a problem that can be treated and maybe even save your life, spiritual stress tests can find problems that may even save your soul. One little sidebar here that's important to consider. James says that Christians should consider it all joy when facing trials. Has this been your experience? Yeah, well, mine neither. But what about Jesus? Was Jesus joyful during his trials and tests? During his greatest one, facing the cross, while in the Garden of Gethsemane, he asked the Father if he could not have to go through Calvary if possible. He was in such agony that Luke records his sweat became like drops of blood. Well, let's look at what the author of Hebrews comments about this in chapter 12, verse 2. He says, speaking of Jesus, because of the joy awaiting him, he endured the cross, disregarded its shame, and now he is seated in the place of honor beside God's throne. Hebrews says Jesus endured his testing because of the joy awaiting him. James says we are to consider it all joy. The joy comes later. So no, trials are not fun. They are not joyful at the time, but they will result in joy later. Let's say you have a professional goal, a dream to work in a specific field. Nowadays, whether it be any of the medically related fields, medicine, nursing, pharmacy, occupational therapy, physical therapy, law, education, information technology, etc., there are requirements that you pass a certifying exam. And these exams are very difficult, and you're worried about it. Now, suppose someone tells you that there's a practice exam for your test being offered in Columbus. However, it's going to cost you some unpleasantness. You're going to have to pay for this to take this exam. You're going to have the inconvenience and cost of traveling up to Columbus, maybe getting up early in the morning or staying in a hotel the night before. You're going to have to spend an entire Saturday that you'd rather have off to take the test, and even the mental effort of spending the day taking the test. But what that test will do is tell you exactly where you're weak at, what you need to focus on to help you pass the certifying exam. Because of the unpleasantness of that practice test, you're able later to pass the real test and find joy in reaching your dream. Now, the point of all this isn't to beat ourselves up. We will never reach the full stature of Christ while we're alive. The point of this is to help us grow into the likeness of Christ as best we can so that we can experience the peace, contentment, and joy that only God can give when we reach that certain status of maturity. So the question is, how do we get a healthy heart? It's one thing to find out our heart is not as good as what we thought, but how do we get it better? How do we get a healthy spiritual heart? And what I'd like to do is piggyback onto and continue with Lowell's thoughts. And if you haven't watched it, please go back and watch Lowell's excellent talk last week, where Lowell talked to us about God speaking to us through prayer, scripture, and circumstances. And for our spiritual hearts to be fixed, we'll need all four. And let me share some suggestions with you that I've found to be helpful. Regarding prayer, you know, wisdom is seeing yourselves, others, and situations exactly how God does. And what I'd like to suggest to you is try this prayer if you haven't. Pray for wisdom that God would show you your heart and that you would see your heart as he does. And feel fully confident, as James says, that if you lack wisdom and you ask God, that it will be given to you. And this is what David did. You know, it's real interesting. I've always found it fascinating that David was called the man after God's own heart. But yet you look at what he did, the sins he committed. But I think the reason David was called a man after God's own heart is because David understood it was all about the heart. And let's look what David's prayers in Psalms. He says in Psalms 26:2, "Test me, Lord, and try me. Examine my heart and my mind." And then chapter 139, 23 through 24, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my concerns. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way." The second suggestion I have regarding prayer is simply pray for a new heart. Ask God to change it. Ask God to give you more love. Ask God to give you more love for Him, more love for others. Ask God to give you a servant's heart. In Psalm 51, David prays, "God, create a clean heart for me and renew a steadfast spirit within me." And in Psalm 86:11, he says, "Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart that I may fear your name." So pray for wisdom. Pray for God to show you your heart, and pray that God would clean up your heart. The second area we need to give attention to is Scripture. Now, there's a little problem we engage in. I wanted to talk about first. And probably most people have an issue with something called attention management. And this is when you only give attention to things you want to hear. Only things that are not unpleasant. Only things you agree with. And we see this typically in the area of politics. If you're a conservative, middle-aged male, you probably take in political content given by a conservative middle-aged male. If you're a liberal, you probably take in content that's put out by a liberal news source. And you know, this is human nature. We probably do this because we like to be reaffirmed we're right. Or maybe we're just a little lazy in doing the mental work and considering an opposing idea. Attention management in politics is one thing. However, attention management is a big problem for us spiritually when we practice at reading Scripture. When we focus on only what we want to hear or what we like. For instance, we focus on the verses that are very easy for us to obey and act on. We attended a church once that preached from the pulpit the sin of drinking alcohol, and everyone would amen. I never met anyone in that church that ever drank alcohol. Pretty easy for them to give up something they never cared about before. We focus on passages about God's unconditional love, forgiveness, heaven, mercy, and grace. But we often ignore those verses about loving your enemies or being gentle with those you disagree with. We ignore those verses about God's testing and God's discipline. Yes, they're in there. He does discipline us. We ignore verses about stewardship and giving, things that make us, that call for sacrifice. We ignore the verses about the consequences of unforgiveness or our obligation to the poor, or even the verses about heaven, or I'm sorry, about hell or judgment. We like the parable of the lost sheep, but we don't like the parable of God's pruning and throwing in fruitful branches in the fire, or of dividing the sheep from the goats. If we want to endure through testing and become more like Christ, we need to look at the entire life and teaching of His kingdom. We can't just pick and choose. So I have some more suggestions. First, read your Bible. But instead of devotional type reading or reading plans, where we're reading just a few verses from a different book and chapter every day, or we're skipping around, read the Bible the way it was written. Read a whole book at a time. Start in chapter 1, verse 1, and read that entire book. And I'd suggest, if you've never done this, to start in the New Testament. Read a gospel, then read 3 or 4 epistles. Read another gospel, read 3 or 4 other epistles, until you've gotten through the entire New Testament. Get some good study help. commentaries or a life application Bible. They're all available on many places. My second suggestion is this. Even if you've only have a GED or high school, we as a culture are extremely highly educated compared to the people of biblical times. And we have a tendency to read the scripture only for information, doctrine, or truth. For scripture to change you, it does need to start in your head with your thinking. It does start there. But to get it to change your heart, you've got to get that scripture from your mind to your heart. So how do we do this? Here's my suggestions. When you pick a book to read it multiple times in a row. Don't just read it once and then move on to another book. Read it 3, 4, 5 times. And as you reread it, you'll begin to hear God more and more. Verses will begin to stick out to you and speak to you. And whenever you find those verses that pop out to you, stop, think, and meditate on it. I'm not talking about yoga meditation. I'm talking about just considering what the word says, thinking about it, just churning it over in your mind. That is how your heart can be changed. That is how that scripture can get from your mind to your heart. For some people, that 18 inches is a long way away, but we need to do that. We need to do that. People, do rooted. Get in a small group. God will use others who discuss their journey of the heart to show you where your heart is and to encourage you in the process of well. You will never reach the maturity level and subsequent joy, peace, and contentment God intended without doing it with other people. Never. If you're not completely satisfied with your spiritual walk, the first thing I'd suggest you to do, get together with other people. That is a biblical command. The fourth thing, circumstances. Our circumstances, the events of our day, our interactions with people can show us the state of our heart in regard to our pride. Pride is the original sin. It poisons the heart, and it's the ultimate root of our sin. Pride is deceiving. You know, we can see pride pretty easily in other people, can't we? But typically, we don't see it in ourselves. Obadiah says, "Your arrogant heart has deceived you." Galatians 6:3, Paul says, "For if anyone considers himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceives himself." Well, how do you know just how much pride you have? Look back on your circumstances of your day. Ask yourself, did you find yourself intolerant of others' mistakes? Do you find yourself having a need for control, being unwilling to work under the direction of others? Do you find yourself unwilling to even consider, not necessarily take, but even consider the advice of others? Do you find yourself having no interest whatsoever in really helping anybody else? Do you find yourself constantly thinking about yourself? If you do things for the church, for God, you find that you have to have recognition, that you're upset if no one recognizes you for what you've done. You found today that you've had trouble admitting your mistakes, to say I'm sorry or ask forgiveness. Have you found a critical spirit? Have you found yourself unable to share needs or ask for help or have any sense of dependence on God for anything? Do you find yourself needing to be right? Have you found yourself today comparing your sins and failings to others and feeling like, you know, I'm not that bad? Did you find yourself not helping someone in need today when you had an opportunity because you thought, I wouldn't have made those choices you did? Has God spoken to you about saying or doing something, speaking up, but you didn't because you didn't want to look foolish? I had an experience today. Talk about a test. I was recently retired, had some time, had a neighbor invited me to play golf. He retired too. And I said, well, this was yesterday. And I says, well, you know, I'm kind of limited. I've got to prepare for, I need to be back. And I need some time to work on this talk. I'm going to be giving it at church. And I said, and he said, that's fine. We'll just play 9 holes. So he wanted to go across the river. We live in Georgetown, over to Maysville. We went over and played. Well, this morning I get back, go for a bike ride. I always do that. I often do that to clear my mind, have a prayer time. I'm ready to get started. And I realize I can't find my wallet. And I think, and I realize that I probably left my wallet in the golf cart yesterday. And I don't know if any of you have ever lost your wallet, had to change your credit card number, get a new driver's license. You know what kind of hassle that is. And I was thinking, I can't let this upset me. And I actually prayed, God, please help someone find that wallet there and turn it in. Well, we got in our small group, one of the great things about a small group is when there's prayer needs, we do group text and we at any time of the day or night. And we had some prayer needs going through here lately. And I remembered to pray for these prayer needs. And trust me, they were all way more important than my wallet. And I found myself today continue thinking more back. I prayed for all the prayer needs once, but I went back several more times and prayed for my wallet. And the Lord is like, do you really think you're losing your wallet is more important than the health of these other people? And I was convicted. So God can use circumstances of any kind to show us where our heart is. So what's the antidote to pride? Well, first of all, as God shows you your heart, He'll deal with your pride, and you'll find your pride easier to deal with. But the most practical advice I can give you to deal with your pride is to go through your day constantly reminding yourself to look for ways to serve and to better the lives of others, even if it's simple stuff. Letting that person who has less stuff than you in their cart go ahead of you. You know, being kind when it's you don't feel like being kind. Smiling to people. Look for ways to serve. So let's sum this up. What's our proper response for a Christian during these times of trials and stress tests of our heart? Don't view these circumstances as stress, but view these circumstances as stress tests for your heart, as opportunities to become more like Christ. Because you will in the future, if you endure these through to the end, you will find that contentment, peace, and joy. And if we have the wisdom to value our character and spiritual maturity more than our comfort, we'll be better off. Pray for God to show you your heart. And pray for God to help you fix it. Meditate on all of Scripture. Don't pick and choose. Go through this process of heart change with other people. And use the circumstances of your day to root out your pride and as an opportunity to serve others. I'm very grateful for our small group. It's been very helpful to me. It's been a great blessing. And again, I have to plug Rooted and small group and just the importance in your spiritual formation. Let's finish with a word of prayer. Father, I just pray once again that your word go forth, bear fruit, Father. Show us your truth. In your name we pray, amen. Now, before we quit, I'd like to just have one more prayer. And there's a lot of needs out there, but there's a particularly need that's been on my heart and my wife's heart and our small group's heart. And Mindy Balzer, who's the daughter of John and Kathy Lepla, and John's on staff, and John and Kathy are they have the heart of Jesus. And Mindy's had some horrific health issues lately. And she is scheduled tomorrow, Friday, at 7:30 a.m. for a procedure that is an extremely complicated procedure called the Whipple's procedure. She will have to be in the intensive care unit for 2 days after the procedure. It's a procedure that's difficult, definite chance of complications, long recovery. And if you're watching this tonight, please pray for Mindy and her family. If you don't get a chance to watch this until tomorrow, there's a good chance Mindy's still going to be in surgery. And if you don't get a chance to watch this till the weekend, Mindy will probably still be in the ICU recovering. So let's just stop for another prayer, and let's lift up Mindy all together. Father, we just pray and thank you that you're such a God who heals and restores. And Father, you're a God of peace. Father, we just pray once again that you heal Mindy, either miraculously or through the hands of the surgeon. Father, we just pray for the whole medical team, that they use their gifts, their skills, their talents and their abilities, those good things that you have given them to bring healing to Mindy. We pray for no complications and a speedy recovery. In your name we pray. God bless.